Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. May I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. We've received apologies today from Marie McNair, and Ruth Maguire is attending as a substitute. And I welcome Ruth to the meeting. And before we turn to our formal agenda, I invite her to declare any relevant interests.
Thank you, Convener. No relevant interests to declare today.
Thank you, Ruth. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence from two panels from witnesses on the Civic Government Scotland Act 1982, Licensing of Short-Term Lets, Amendment Order 2023. On our first panel today, we're joined in the room by Professor Cliff Haig, Chartered Town Planner and Chair of the Coburn Association, Rob Dixon, who's the Director of Industry and Destination Development at Visit Scotland, and Ailsa Raeburn, who's the Chair of Community Land Scotland. And online, we're joined by Gillian McNaught, who's a legal manager at the Licensing and Democratic Services of Glasgow City Council, and Gary Somers, who's a solicitor of licensing at Highland Council. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting, and we will try to direct our questions to specific witnesses where possible. But if you would like to come in, please indicate this to the clerks, or for those of you appearing virtually, please do this by typing an R in the chat function. I'd like to begin. I just want to kind of frame the context of this meeting with a couple of bits from our briefing papers. So the policy note that accompanied the licensing order explained that it was to establish a scheme to ensure short-term lets are safe and address issues faced by neighbours, and to facilitate local authorities in knowing and understanding what is happening in their area, as well as to assist with handling complaints effectively. On the 7th of December 2022, we received communication from Shona Robinson, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government. And she said in that letter, "I'm writing to advise you that we intend to lay an affirmative Scottish statutory instrument in January 2023 that will seek to amend the Civic Government Scotland Act 1982 Licensing of Short-Term Lets Order 2022. This is an order to amend the date by which existing hosts must apply for a short-term let licence from 31st of March 2023 to the 30th of September 2023. This is a one-off six-month extension, recognising the wider economic circumstances of the cost of living crisis that is placing pressure on existing short-term lets hosts and businesses at a time when they are organising and budgeting for work to comply with the new licensing requirements." So I thought I would just do that to remind us as to really the purpose of today. We might start to explore other areas, but I just wanted to give us that framing. So I'm going to start the questions. And I think this one, having said we're going to direct the questions, this is possibly one for everyone to respond to. So I'd be interested to hear if your organisation supports or opposes the proposed six-month extension to the date by which existing hosts must have submitted an application for a short-term let licence. I'd be interested to hear a bit more detail of why you think this, and also if you could set out what you think the implications of the delay might be from your perspective. And maybe I'll just start with Rob.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you very much. I think the position for Visit Scotland is complex. Obviously, as a government agency, we are charged with doing a range of things. And in the current position, our main focus is to bring together through an industry advisory group those organisations which have, I think, the most significant role in helping to understand the situation we find ourselves in, and in trying to make sure that the industry, in all its various guises, sole practitioners through to quite large commercial operators, are best able to manage the implications of the new legislation, and that the impacts of this are managed in such a way that they have minimal impact on the consumer as well. So In respect of the benefits of the delay, I think what it does, and we'll maybe come on to some of this detail, is allow further time to assist and work with local authorities to improve the understanding of what is required here, to ease some of the pressures that are on the sector in terms of how they can comply with the legislation, and particularly try and address some of the anomalies that we've seen occur in relation to the introduction of the legislation. So that time, that additional time, is potentially a benefit in that space. I think equally for local authorities, it means that the delay pushes the likely timeframe in which the majority of applications are going to come through back. There is an inevitability with a deadline such as the one with this legislation that the applications will come in a wave towards the deadline, whenever it's set. But there's a particular complication, I think, for this sector in terms of the delay and the date, because, of course, actually the date lands at the end of the very busy summer period. So as opposed to a 31st of March or April cut-off, when you're asking businesses to complete the work during a winter and somewhat quieter period, you're actually asking it now to take place over the busiest summer peak period. So there are pros and cons about the delay, but I think we can probably address some of the concerns during the period of the delay and hope that we can deal with some of the complexity and some of the implications that have undoubtedly been felt by local authorities and by the industry. I can expand on some of those points later, but that would be my opening.
Thank you very much for that. I wonder, I think that's a really good point you raise about the seasonality and the kind of like end of summer, busy season. I wonder if there's any, in your mind, and along with the work you're doing with the industry advisory group, and we're going to go in some more detail with that, but just touching on that, is there a way that we could start to actually encourage people to be applying ahead of that time to kind of minimise that delay?
Yes, and through the work of various sector organisations and through Visit Scotland and the government as well, there's been marketing done and communication work done to try and encourage applicants to apply early, to get on and do the work. And I think there's been an effort to do that. My understanding is that the government will continue to ask businesses to do that. But we all know in whatever period or frame we're looking at that a deadline is a deadline and the applications will come at the end of the process. I think we probably can't avoid that.
I would agree with you. I know all about that kind of thing. I'm going to go to Gillian. Have you got anything to add? And what's your perspective from Glasgow City Council?
Yes, thank you very much for inviting me to attend this morning. From Glasgow City Council's perspective, the proposed delay would allow the existing hosts more time to apply for their application. My learned friend, Mr Dixon, did say there's always a concern that perhaps applicants will wait till the end of a deadline to apply. That was a concern in relation to the end of March date that was set. That would be still existing, that concern, for the 30th of September deadline if it was approved. I don't think there's any way around that. We can all, Glasgow City Council, can try, as we have been doing, to encourage applicants to apply early. But there's obviously a realistic concern of them ensuring that they are in a position to apply with trades and their application being up to the standard required. In relation to the administrative burden, perhaps, on licensing authorities, given there's no proposed reduction in the processing times, there's no concern from Glasgow City Council in relation to that part of the proposal.
Thanks very much. And Ailsa.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to speak today. We're opposed to any delay for a number of reasons. I think the concern around cost of living is misplaced, because those most affected by the cost of living crisis are not individuals who own several short-term lets. It's the people that can't get houses who are most affected by the cost of living crisis, and that's obviously hugely impacted by the number of properties that are being turned over to short-term lets in urban and rural areas. And we must remember that people who own houses and want to let them out can still do so. They can still generate really significant income from private rented tenancies. So it's not as if they're being left with no income at all. I think the delay will worsen the cost of living crisis for those most at risk. The impending legislation was already noticeably being felt in terms of properties that were coming back on the market for rent, and we see that that stopped overnight once the proposals for a delay were announced, which is impacting hugely on the credibility of the scheme and whether it's ever going to be brought into place. So I think that really needs to be borne in mind. We know that poor tourist accommodation will be unsafe and unlawful for longer. One of the main purposes of the legislation was to improve the safety standards. All we're doing is allowing another busy season to operate with accommodation that is not meeting those standards. And as I see it, there's no interim measures to ensure that properties are brought up to standard in the short term. We were assured by the industry in the first place that all operators were already operating to safe standards and that actually legislation and licensing wasn't required, and yet we're now being told that actually they can't bring those properties up to standard. So there's some issue there. Were properties at standard and didn't need licensing, or are they not at standard and actually we need a longer period for licensing because they can't get the contractors? So there's an issue there. I think local authorities do understand what is required, and they've each produced their own schemes which have sort of local nuance. We agree that local authorities should be able to include local conditions because they know their local areas. I think a delay also gives more time to dangerous and unlawful operators. There are a significant number of operators who we know are operating in properties that won't get planning consent, particularly in Edinburgh, but they'll continue to operate without licensing and without planning. And I think the other thing, it also penalises, a delay further penalises those people who have already applied. So there are lots of people who did take cognizance of the legislation coming forward and did try to get ahead of the game, did bring their properties up to standard, and now they're going to be penalised if there's a further delay. And I think the final thing for us is the whole issue of the 10-year planning rule, that properties, if they've been operating for 10 years in this particular use, no longer require to apply for planning commission. And I'm sure Professor Haig will know more about this. But the longer the licensing scheme is delayed, then the longer it is before local authorities can start to implement short-term control area orders, and those properties that are sort of 8, 9, 10 years in operation will be able to claim lawful existing use rather than being required to apply for planning consent. So I think there's a huge risk the more we delay the implementation of the scheme, because local authorities have quite rightly said that they need to wait for the implementation of the licensing scheme to understand numbers, to understand then where issues of concentration apply, and therefore those are the areas where they might look at short-term let control area orders. So the longer you delay implementing the licensing, the longer it will be before those control area orders can be brought into play. So I think there's a huge number of concerns if we delay it further. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that. I'll go to Gary, who's online from Highland Council. What's your perspective from Highland Council?
Good morning. Thanks. Thanks for asking me along to speak this morning. I can echo some of the sentiments that have been shared by my learned colleague, Ms. McNaught. The Highland Council, I understand from our discussions with other local authorities, I think we've got the highest number of applications which have been received for a short-term let licence, and we're currently sitting at 809 applications. I would say that in terms of the benefits of it, we had a number of the proposed delay. I'd say that we had a number of rural and remote communities, particularly in the Small Isles Community Council, which is Rum, Egg, Muck and Canna, who had said that based on the existing timelines that they had struggled to be able to get tradesmen and professionals to visit these islands, particularly over the winter months. So they had said that there had been some difficulty in complying with certain mandatory conditions. So I understand that those communities in particular would have welcomed the proposed delay. The terms of the impact that the delays had on the Highland Council itself, we have employed various new members of staff in both our legal and environmental health teams in order to meet the legislative requirements of the short-term legislation and to cope with the anticipated volume of applications for our area, which, based upon existing data, we estimate there could be up to 10,000 existing short-term let properties in the Highland Council area. Our budgets for setting up and implementing the STL regime and the associated process and the costs for employing members of staff were calculated and justified on the basis of the income we anticipated we would receive based on the level of applications with the existing deadline. Effectively, based on the projected application numbers and in order to meet the processing teams, we required 14 new members of staff for our legal team and 6.3 new members of staff from our environmental health team across a number of posts. But since we are now being advised that the majority of existing hosts are going to wait until much closer until the new deadline to submit their applications, we've concern on the impact this could have on our budgets and the income that we will receive and the position for these members of staff. In particular, some of the new members of staff where their appointments were only justified if they were based on a fixed term basis, and those fixed terms are due to expire in October 2023, when we would have anticipated that the majority, the bulk of STL licence applications would have been received and processed. So due to the delay in the income that we will receive from application fees from existing hosts and due to the current funding position generally with local authorities, there's no guarantees that these posts can be extended. So in the event that we cannot extend the contracts, we risk being unable to have the necessary staff in place to process applications at the now likely peak time, which in turn risks delays and a significant impact the systems and processes that we've already put in place. And it also creates the risk of deemed the grant of a licence for a period of 12 months if applications are not processed within statutory timescales, which of course carries a reputational risk for the Council and the wider scheme. And I think my final point for the moment is that we would just comment that immediately after the proposed delay was announced, we received quite a number of inquiries and a number of misinformation that appears to be out there, which said that there were potentially going to be further deadlines or other amendments to the STL licence and legislation. And we would comment that that would lead to a risk of a possible loss or a partial loss of confidence in the licensing regime more generally. So, I think any further amendments also risk a further misinformation more generally, and as I say, together with a loss of confidence and perhaps a risk of a lack of compliance with the short-term let licensing regime.
Thanks very much for that, Gary. I'm just interested, you talked about there being, I think, 809 applications currently out of an expected up to 10,000. I think that's what I heard.
Yeah.
Of those 809, are you going to continue processing those applications that are already in, or are you putting a halt on that?
Oh no, absolutely no. We are processing all the applications that are coming in. We are continuing. We've got the systems and processes in place. We've got the staff. We're issuing licences. So yeah, absolutely, still processing those and encouraging as many applicants as possible to submit their applications well in advance of the deadline. We're doing awareness, raising awareness by attending tourism conferences, by hosting seminars with local chambers of commerce, with other chambers of commerce throughout the Highlands, with booking platforms such as Airbnb, GrowBiz, and attending in person some other Highland Tourism Board conferences. So we are very much getting the message out there to applicants and prospective applicants, please submit your application as soon as possible. It's just that what we have received is some feedback from applicants which have said, you know, we appreciate that, but if there's no real benefit to us submitting our application. Some applicants have said to us that there's no incentive for them to submit their application before the new deadline, because they've pointed out that if they submit their application now and their STL licence is issued, the renewal date for the licence will fall sooner than if they just leave it closer to the deadline date. And I think that that kind of marries up with then that marries up to the availability of tradesmen and professionals. And a lot of existing applicants, a lot of people have already made their applications, had expressed some concern because they had went to great lengths and great expense in getting tradesmen and getting professionals to attend their properties in order to make their application based on the existing timelines. And some had expressed, especially in remote areas, some had expressed that this was a quite considerable expense. So there had been some concern and grievance from those who had already submitted their application. And they've also said that they think it's unfair that their renewal, they view it sometimes as that their renewal will be due sooner than if they had waited until the new proposed deadline. And that they've said that their counterparts who have not submitted their licence will effectively get another season without having to have submitted their licence. That's, and again, just echoing some of the earlier sentiments about the seasonal nature of it, I think that's where that really comes in, that the way that they're seeing it is they're, if you don't submit your licence, if you don't submit your application just now, you could get another season for then your renewal would be due later than if you submitted it just now.
Great. OK, thanks very much. Thanks for that, going into a bit more detail there. Cliff Haig.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you for the invitation to address the committee this morning. I'm chair of the Coburn Association, which is the civic trust in Edinburgh, established in 1875. And we exist to protect and enhance the beauty of Edinburgh and for everybody who loves Edinburgh. So our Edinburgh, we've got an Edinburgh focus, and we are opposed to the proposed delay. And that reflects a number of things. Basically, the question of why we need to regulate the industry has been settled. It's an industry that is self-proclaimed a disruptor and has substantially disrupted communities within Edinburgh and the networks that they operate within. The Parliament has already agreed that regulation is necessary for reasonable grounds, as Ailes was saying about safety, fire safety, gas safety, that properties should be wind and watertight, that we should know how many, there should be a maximum number of people who can be staying in property and so on. All entirely reasonable propositions for any regulatory body. So the question really is why, if we know that we need to regulate this, we've agreed that, if it's right to do it next year, why is it right to do it now? Why delay? The implications of the delay, I think, should be seen to try and fill gaps that haven't been covered already, is that we've already had a long process of consultation on this general issue. March 2018, virtually 5 years ago, the Coburn ran a half-day conference on the issue of short-term lets, which we invited a broad spectrum of people, including people from the industry, as speakers. And at that stage, it was very clear that there was a serious issue to be addressed. That was 2018. There was then a consultation that followed in 2019. The Scottish Government then reported in October 2019, came forward with proposals January 2020. There was then a further consultation in December 2020 on those proposals, and that led to finally legislation in January 2022, and that came into effect essentially in April of that year. So we've had a long period of consultation, which many community groups have engaged in good faith. And what it now appears to be to them is that their arguments have been set aside in relation to more powerful lobbying by commercial interests. And this itself creates a kind of distrust of the consultation process. And I think that should be recognised, that if we go down this step, anybody, I think, outside those lobbying is going to see this as some kind of caving in. And that I think is really negative in terms of the confidence in the Parliament and the accountability. Also, I think the implications of a delay are that it just further delays action on moving some of these properties that were taken out of availability for local people and workers, taking these out of the short-term let market and putting them back into long-term residential occupation. And that reflects the scale of properties we lost in Edinburgh. I mean, it's literally in the thousands in a city where there's already pressure on housing. I think the other concern is that this is being called a one-off, but the cost of living crisis isn't going to be a something that's resolved by October, I'm afraid. And similarly, I can only see the same kind of arguments then being used again for a further delay or to try to unpick the basic legislation. Finally, I'm conscious that I think Festivals Edinburgh has given evidence. I've seen stuff in the Scotsman on this. And I don't think it's the role of this committee to decide how the festivals should organise themselves in a way that meets the changing situation externally. But what I would say, and I'd happily expand on it later, is I think you should look carefully at the kind of data that's being presented there, because I would question some of the impacts that are being predicted. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you much to everyone for a very good beginning of this conversation. I think maybe the next question I will actually direct to you, Rob. What evidence, if any, is there that short-term lets licensing, the regime, is adversely affecting Scotland's tourist economy? Or is it too early to tell?
I think it's probably too early to tell. I wonder if I may make a wider observation just about regulation and the introduction of regulation. We've heard quite a large amount from the business sector, not just tourism, but more broadly about the introduction of regulation and the complexity of doing that at a time when the cost of doing business is particularly challenging. And I think it follows on quite logically from Professor Hayes' point about the length of consultation and the length of consideration the Parliament gave. My understanding is that in this specific instance, once the guidance was produced, councils in March last year had the guidance available, and then between about March and the 1st of October had to produce their policies and implement those policies. The reality is that in that time period, and I say this having worked in local authorities for 20 years, the reality is that in that time period it coincided with local government elections. It was a period when councils had to observe a pre-election period, and therefore difficulty with public consultation about what their policies might be, and even discussion with local businesses about what the policy might be, an inevitable turnover in councillors, which presents difficulties for officers in doing the work necessary. I think the impact of that we now see in some of the inconsistencies in council policies, and I want to be quite clear, it is entirely right that each council makes a decision on their own policy. However, what we've seen is some interpretation of the guidance which suggests that other policy areas have been used to define the short let licensing policies, for example, houses in multiple occupation and others, and that actually there's some points of detail here which perhaps emerge from lack of clarity in the guidance or perhaps emerge because of misunderstanding with councils, and I think can be addressed in the delay period in order to try and make sure that the ease with which this legislation can be used and the benefits which the legislation bring that have been referred to can be realised. There's some complexity in that and some detail in that, I apologise, but I genuinely think that it's too early to say presently what the overall impact will be. The Highland numbers have been quoted. My understanding is that in Edinburgh There are 40 applications currently in. We know as Visit Scotland that within our own quality assurance scheme, we have 539 businesses registered. So that's less than 10% registered. And the numbers that are beyond that are routinely referred to as being, quote, thousands, unquote. So I think it is too early to say. What is beyond doubt as being the case is that there are additional costs for businesses in this. That is reasonable because the Parliament has decided that this will be an area that is regulated. I don't think there's anything unreasonable in that. But what needs to be done is that the guidance and the implementation of this is smooth as much as possible in order to make it easier for councils and easier for applicants for licences.
Thank you very, very much for that. Did anyone else want to come in on this, their take on the impact on the tourist economy? No. Okay. We're going to move on to, and just to say, Rob, I really appreciate complexity and detail, and those examples are really helpful because I think we need to get, you know, get that understanding. Willie, you'd like to come in.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to everyone on the panel. Two of the issues that have cropped up during our consideration of this are the potential impact that the licensing scheme might have on the availability of homes to buy or rent, long-term lets and so on and so forth, and the whole issue about antisocial behaviour, whether it will be improved, reduced or increased or otherwise. Would you have any evidence at the moment to offer the committee of any signs or any movement in these two areas? Maybe start with Gillian, maybe Gillian and Gary from the two councils, and Professor Haig, you led on that a moment ago in one of those aspects. But firstly, I wonder if I could ask Gillian or Gary for a comment on that, if you have any evidence to support these claims at all.
Thank you very much for your question. I don't have any evidence at the present time in relation to those two aspects, availability of homes and the antisocial behaviour. I think just given the infancy of the licensing regime, just from the 1st of October, I certainly have no evidence or data to feed back to committee today on that.
Okay. Gary from the Highland, is there any movement or trends that you can observe up there? Or?
Conclusions we don't have. It's too early to draw any firm conclusions. We don't have enough data available at the moment.
Okay. Professor Haig, I'll turn to you. You mentioned it a moment ago about the potential impact here and some of the concerns that you expressed very well that have been there since 2018 in the series of events and processes that you were part of and some of those concerns. Is it fair to ask you about how you would anticipate the impact of the licensing scheme on those two issues from any conversations that you have had with colleagues?
Yeah, we don't collect systematic data, and one difficulty with this industry is that particularly Airbnb is very difficult to get regular data from. You usually have to do some sort of data scrape to get figures. What we do have, we chair the Civic Forum, which meets quarterly, and there's pretty regularly the issue of short-term lets comes up in that with people with anecdotal evidence, and I can't say more than that, of the impact, particularly obviously on tenement stairs. And all this, in a sense, has been agreed. You know, that there's no doubt that the presence of party flats and so forth can be very disruptive on a stair. It's particularly upsetting to older people who are concerned about the presence of strangers in the stair and a constant turnover, etc., etc. Similarly, we've taken around in 2019, it stopped with COVID, our unique city, which was a sort of platform in relation to City Plan 2030 and trying to look at the future of Edinburgh. So we had some community meetings around on that, and again, at every one of those, the issue came up, and the stories were interchangeable. So I think there's no doubt that the one benefit of the legislation being implemented now will be that it begins to normalise what became a very abnormal situation across much of Edinburgh, not just the city centre, but has spread out into to other areas of the city. What was the first bit? I couldn't, again.
It was really about whether you anticipate that there will be a change in those two areas. Like, will it impact the long-term lets and properties, rents to buy and so on? Will it really have an impact in there? Because that's very much been raised at the committee during our process, and the antisocial behaviour issue has been very much at the heart of that debate too, and whether you think there will be movement either way in both of those key areas.
Well, I think that the legislation clearly intends there to be a long-term change. That's the, in a sense, one of the points of bringing it in. It isn't necessary to abolish the industry, because I think the point that's not been made is that, you know, people can at the moment get a temporary exemption during this period after April. So the long term pattern, though, is clearly has to be to particularly those lets which are whole property, potentially 365 days a year, to return those properties into living spaces for people who live and work in the city.
Thank you. Ailsa, do you have any additional perspective on those two issues that you could offer us?
Yeah, I think when you look at a lot of surveys, so the High Survey, My Life in the Highlands and Islands, which was done in the last 12 months, so 75% of respondents said there are not enough houses at a reasonable price, 78% in Argyll and 63% overall say there are too many houses used as short-term lets and second homes. There was a recent Insight report into the housing needs of businesses on Skye and Lough Ouse, that was June last year, where between 1,300 and 1,700 positions were difficult to fill because of a lack of accommodation, because of the huge change in housing moving over to short-term lets. We've seen in places like Plockton, a third of the dwellings now in Plockton and District are used as short-term lets and second homes. And on the main street, for any of you that know it, Harbour Street in Plockton, 51% of houses are now used as short-term lets and second homes. Badenoch and Strathspey, they've lost 17% of their housing stock to this type of accommodation. So the figures, particularly in rural areas, and I'd let Cliff speak about Edinburgh, but in rural areas, they're really, really stark, the loss of housing stock to this type of use, and which means that, you know, you can't get nurses, you can't get teachers, you can't get care workers. These communities are literally dying because you can't retain the key services required to make a community work because people cannot get homes. And that's, you know, without sort of young families wanting to move back, because the vast majority of the housing stock, a huge proportion of the housing stock in places like Tyree, it's 46%. The figures are equally stark on Mull. You know, they've moved over to this type of use and been lost to full-time residential use.
Very much for that. I wonder if I could ask a secondary question to Rob, please. Rob, you were talking a moment ago about whether the licensing scheme is other parts of legislation are being used and applied, and the delay might give local authorities more time to clarify and consolidate their understanding of all of that. So how well do you think the licensing scheme proposals are understood by accommodation providers, and is this delay period going to help to fully make it, you know, clear and understood across the sector?
I think the operators of the properties, the applicants for the licences, have varying degrees of knowledge. I think there's a range of organisations that have worked incredibly hard, councils included, but others in this tourism sector, particularly organisations relating to the sector, have worked incredibly hard to explain what the purpose of the licensing is, to explain the processes around the licensing, and to explain some of the intricacies between particularly planning and the license application process. I think that work has been highly beneficial, but I still think there is a considerable amount to be done to make sure that all those operating in the market understand what they need to understand, are in a position to apply for a licence correctly and be granted a licence if that's what the council decide to do. So I think that work is incomplete. I am sure that the months that are being given by the delay will allow the situation to improve, but I don't think that of itself is a valid reason for the extension. I think there are other reasons as to why the extension has been granted, or is being considered, sorry, and may be granted by the Parliament. And some of the benefits that accrue from that, I think, are what already been said. I wouldn't underestimate how challenging this has been, particularly, for example, for operators with properties in different council areas, because they're operating with different policies and different schemes. That's entirely appropriate. Individual councils can make those decisions. But as I said earlier, there are some points of detail around matters pertaining, for example, to floor plans and habitable standards, which are being drawn from a range of different pieces of legislation that are complicated. I don't profess to understand all of the detail myself, but we've certainly seen a plethora of examples from operators and applicants as to where some of this complexity sits. So further explanation, further guidance and education will be helpful, and clearly Visit Scotland will continue to play our part in trying to do that, to improve the understanding in the sector.
Thank you. I know the issue about the floor plans is coming up later, so I'll wait and allow my colleague to ask that question. Thanks very much to everybody. Thanks, convener.
That's the point where we want more detail on that.
I'll consider myself forewarned then.
Yes. Just a quick supplementary on that in terms of the understanding for accommodation providers. Would you say that because I think MSPs are probably getting emails about this from people, should we direct them to Visit Scotland or to get assistance and support, or should we direct them to somewhere within the local authority?
Either or. Yeah. Rather depends what the question is, to be honest. Yeah. If it's specific to the policy of a council, the council's the best organisation to provide the answer on that detail. If it's a more generic one about the overall scheme and the details and the processes, then visitscotland.org, our business pages on the website there are able to provide good levels of information and support. And the government site itself has good information as well. So there's a range of online help and support that's available and some specialist support behind that.
Just another one. So Ailsa talked about the challenges for communities, that are being hollowed out in a way, my words, not hers, by the fact that they can't find housing for teachers or nurses, basically, public sector services. But I also am aware, being a Highlands and Islands MSP, but there's a challenge for accommodation for people, ironically, who work in the hospitality sector. Do you recognise that is kind of like this ironic issue, that on one hand, there's the short-term lets industry, but on the other hand, there's other hospitality services that actually the people who come to stay in short-term lets might want to avail themselves of, who then can't actually get a meal in a hotel because they can't accommodate their staff?
I absolutely recognise that and the criticality of that issue. I think the issue of housing in many parts of Scotland, but particularly in the more rural areas in the north and in the south, is now perhaps the most critical factor in terms of our economy. As a director of Visit Scotland, I attend the Convention of the South of Scotland and the Convention of the Highlands and Islands, chaired by the Deputy First Minister. The Deputy First Minister, in providing evidence, I think, to the Finance Committee on the budget a matter of weeks ago, summarised what he had heard at the conventions of the Highlands and Islands pertaining to housing. I would not demur from a word of what he said or what was said at the convention meeting. This is a significant issue that requires considerable thought. And I know at the next meeting, the Convention of the Highlands and Islands, they're dedicating a lot of time to discuss this. So I absolutely recognise the issues. The issues are experienced in different ways by different sectors. It's probably not a point I need to expand on here, but absolutely recognise what's being said.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. I'm now going to bring in Paul McClellan.
Thanks, convener. Can you almost touch on this? It's almost asking a question around about, is the licensing regime acting as a barrier to new entrants into the short-term letting market? And if this is a problem, how could it be tackled? And I know we've kind of touched on that. So, Ailsa, I'll maybe come to yourself and maybe Cliff after that, but I think you've kind of touched on that. I don't know if you've anything else to add on that.
Is it a barrier to new entrants?
Yes. I suppose the balance is, coming back, we're talking about there's the short-term licensing, there's also the short-term control areas, which are kind of different but related. Mm-hmm. So it's maybe trying to be that nuanced kind of question as well, and in that regard, the difference between the control area and the licensing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I think, with the exception perhaps of Edinburgh, most local authorities are waiting till the licensing scheme is implemented before they then think about planning. And from a sort of community's perspective, we were really keen to see the overprovision policy included in the original legislation, and it was obviously removed because that would give communities control, or at least a say in saying, right, well, in our community of Plockton or Tyree or Mull or Toby Alec or wherever, actually, we think there should be a maximum of 20% of our housing stock for this use, because that then enables our community to stay vibrant and stay viable. We've got housing, etc. So in that respect, yes, if you've only got a limited number of potential licences available, then that would potentially stop new entrants until a licence did become available. I'm not convinced that's a particular issue. I think the issues are more on actually how do we make more affordable housing stock available, not how do we make more self-catering lets available, because I think we've seen that the market is fairly saturated. And I think from what you see from some of the industry, the numbers are really down, they haven't got the bookings, etc. Well, is that an argument? Actually, the market is saturated and a lot of these properties are sitting empty when actually they should be in full-time residential use to support the sustainability of those communities. So I don't, you know, I would say that, and I know people who have made the applications for short-term lets, and it is a straightforward process. The form is really straightforward, it's really clear. It's bringing it to a parity with private residential tenancies in terms of safety requirements, because previously to operate a short-term let there was very little you were required to do in terms of safety and security for your customers. So I don't think that's a particular issue. I think you can apply, people are applying, there are new applications, so I don't think there's a barrier. But as I say, I don't think that's the issue. I think the issue is much broader.
Thanks, Elsa. Cliff, just on that one, and obviously your context in Edinburgh, what your thoughts are on that one, because obviously we've got the control area, we're looking at licensing as well in terms of that. And I suppose some of the feedback that I've had is in terms of how complex some of the application process has been in Edinburgh in terms of that. So I don't know what your experience of that is. And I suppose the key thing is coming back to evidence-based. You mentioned about previous discussions that had gone on in terms of what Edinburgh's position is, where you think that's been based on evidence that they've had taken over the number of years, about what their current approach is in terms of licensing and control area?
Well, I think it's a virtue of the legislation that was passed that it actually did devolve things down to local governments, because that allows them to define what they think is appropriate for their area, because one of the features of Scotland, clearly as in most countries, is that there's differential market pressures across different regions. So in a sense, a one-size-fits-all wouldn't be totally appropriate. And if an authority really wants to go for short-term lets as a way to develop their local economy, I don't see this legislation stopping them doing that. They don't need to declare a control area or anything like that. They can have a very relaxed process. I think more widely, and picking up perhaps just from an earlier question, I think this issue about the availability of accommodation for other low key workers who are relatively low paid is certainly an issue in Edinburgh as well. And that also has some environmental implications. The more that we push people further out of the city to find affordable accommodation, the more it creates congestion coming into the city, the more it undermines the net zero aspirations of the city as well. So, you know, this runs out in a number of directions. I also think it's important to recognise that the industries of health and education, along with financial services, really are the key employers in Edinburgh. I'm not putting down the tourist industry, it is significant, but we can overestimate it at times. And, you know, the real bedrock of the Edinburgh economy are those services, many of which have got quite low-income people working within them. So to sustain the quality of life of citizens and the quality of those services, and the hierarchy of expertise that there is in those areas, from, you know, janitors to research scientists, from, you know, people pushing trolleys to surgeons, we actually need to have that supply of housing there. And also, I think this links into the government's aspirations on community wealth building. One difficulty with the existing model is, while yes, we know that historically it was somebody sleeping on your couch that was the short-term let, we also know that there's been a lot of investors, as Rob was saying there, you know, people may own properties in several authorities. And that isn't actually community wealth building. That's community wealth extraction, because that money doesn't circulate then in that local economy, but it goes into the bank account of the property owner. So I think there's a range of factors here. If you begin to really analyse the economic impact, it becomes more complex than just pulling figures out of the air and saying, oh, this is going to be a hit to the economy. You know, we really should be looking to build much more sustainable long-term economies. And I don't really see that the existing model of relatively unregulated short-term lets contributes to that. And I think that delaying this introduction sends really the wrong message out to people.
Thanks for that. And I don't know if Gillian or Gary want to add on that from a council point of view, whether you've any thoughts on that at all, you know, whether you've seen any applications. I know it's maybe slightly out with your bailiwick, but I don't know if you've picked up with other council colleagues.
Yeah, no, thank you. We, in terms of whether it's a barrier to new entrants to the short-term let market, again, it's still very early days as to whether the wider implications that we could have. What I can say is that, practically speaking, especially over the last couple of weeks, we've had a lot of inquiries from prospective new hosts who have not yet completed their purchase of a short-term let property. They could be in the process of purchasing that. We have had a number of inquiries, a number of discussions with prospective purchasers, prospective sellers, lenders, relationship managers for high street lenders, brokers. They have raised grievances because, whilst a purchaser of a property can still technically apply if they have control over the use of the property that they're purchasing, practically they have said that they have difficulty complying with all of the mandatory conditions until they are the owner of the property. In particular, prospective new hosts who are funding their purchase with loan funds from a lender have reported that the lenders won't release loan funds until they have an STL licence in place. So therefore, the knock-on effect is that they can't conclude an unconditional contract for their purchase until they can guarantee having loan funds in place, which has a knock-on effect to when they are able to exercise control over the property. So there is a kind of a chicken and egg scenario going on there. Local authorities can't give provisional licence numbers to new hosts under the terms of the STL legislation. STL licences are not transferable, and we've received, as I say, a number of inquiries. I think because we're moving towards the spring season, where we typically have a number of, and again, this is mostly anecdotal evidence, where we know that properties are typically bought and sold at this time of year in the winter so that they can start to operate and into the spring season. We've seen a number of inquiries and quite a bit of frustration from prospective new hosts who have said that they can't complete the purchase of the property. And conversely, we've seen it from sellers of properties who are saying we can't sell our STL property because they're the buyer or the buyer's lender have raised issues with that. So that's a practical point. That's a point that's impacting it in the immediate future, more than, you know, kind of longer term policy points that some others have raised. But as I say, in the practical point of view, that is a point of frustration which we are having raised with us on a very regular basis, I've got to say.
No, Gary, thanks for that. And I've received similar feedback to that myself in terms of that. Gillian, anything else to add and just on that same question?
Thank you. In relation to Glasgow licensing doesn't have any evidence in relation to saying that the short-term let licensing regime is a barrier to short-term lets being available or on the, you know, becoming into the system. I think it's too early, but also I think you did state that maybe it perhaps doesn't actually sit with licensing to assess that, okay. But we've no evidence to date.
Gillian, thanks for that.
Thank you.
Convener, I think my next question will kind of be picked up later on anyway, okay. So that's me. Thanks.
Thank you, Paul. Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to ask a couple of different questions. I'll start with regards to temporary exemptions. I wondered, Rob, whether or not you think the system governing temporary exemptions from the licensing regime for major events is working as it was expected. I believe Edinburgh City Council had looked to create a specific scheme originally around the festivals. So just wondered where we are today with the legislation, how you think that's working.
I think if others have commented, it's probably too early to say. One of the difficulties we've got here is that we've got very limited numbers of applicants and therefore very limited numbers of licences granted and processes being completed. I think the intention to have short-term exemptions is sound, particularly pertaining to events. Inevitably, the festivals in Edinburgh have been highlighted because of their profile and the significance in terms of the numbers, but there's plenty of other events around Scotland. Open Golf Championship is one that not every year occurs, but you know, does reasonably frequently occur as another example. So I think, you know, the notion of doing that is sound. Actually, how the process is going to operate and whether it facilitates the volumes of accommodation to be released that would traditionally have been released and that festival organisers, major event organisers would want to see released, I think is just too early to say at the moment.
Thank you for that. And do you think when looking at large-scale events, for example, the whole bidding process recently around Eurovision and where that would go, that this is impacting on Scotland's potential to host these sorts of events and have accommodation available for such large-scale, sometimes one-off events like that?
I don't think it's impacting as yet, and I think we would need to wait and see how the process flows and how it operates to see whether those people who would be interested in allowing their property to be used as temporary short-term accommodation would follow the process, would get the exemption that they need, whether they think that that's straightforward enough for a single short-term let. Different people do this in different ways. Some of them might do it a couple of times a year. Somebody in Edinburgh might just do it for the purpose of the festival. Somebody doing it for the Open Golf in a particular venue would only be doing it once every 6, 7, 8 years, perhaps. So I think it's very difficult to judge presently whether what we've got would work or not.
Yeah. Thank you. As we've heard already this morning, the committee's been hearing how the licensing scheme is being applied inconsistently across Scotland. I know both in terms of Highland and Glasgow City Council, they're requesting proof of planning permission or a certificate of lawfulness as part of the licensing requirement, rather than deferring to planning departments to consider this on a case-by-case basis. Understand from my own local authority, they're only requiring evidence of planning or planning control for a planning control area. So I wondered if you could comment on that, both Gary and Gillian, in terms of consistency of applying the legislation.
I'll let you go first, Gillian.
Thank you, and thanks very much for that question. In relation to the planning permission in Glasgow, yes, it is a requirement as part of the licensing application. The planning position in Glasgow has been there for several years. So in relation to the what we're asking in terms of the licensing, we're making sure that the planning side of it has been that's been in place for many years is being complied with before they submit their application. So that's the planning is nothing new in relation to what is expected and what is currently required for people that are currently operating a short-term let in Glasgow.
Gary, do you have anything else you want to add or same rationale?
Just effectively that I think there is no requirement. When we are processing applications, there's no requirement for an applicant to provide us with evidence of planning permission as part of their initial short-term licensing application. And indeed, we advise that planning permission and whether that's required for your specific property is a separate legislative matter. And it's something that we would ask the applicant or the individual making the inquiry to pick up with our planning department separately and ask them for it. So, no, there's, I don't know if that's misinformation, but we don't ask for proof of planning permission as part of the short-term let licence, but an applicant may require it under that separate legislative regime.
Right. Thank you. Thanks for that clarity. I wanted to move on to floor plans. I've become our committee's floor plan man on this piece of work, but I wondered in terms of that's one of the key concerns which have been expressed to us, where different local authorities are requiring detailed floor plans of a property to support an application. So I just wondered in terms of simplicity and what actually has maybe become a misinterpretation of legislation, what your understanding is, for example, is a simple hand-drawn plan of a property over a full architect's drawing accepted? And so I'll maybe bring Gary and Gillian back in on that, and if anyone else wants to comment.
Thank you very much for that additional question. In relation to the floor plan, there is a requirement in Glasgow that there is a floor plan submitted with an application, the scale of 1 to 50, showing specific things, the room sizes, fire escapes and such like. There's been nothing agreed by committee that floor plan needs to be an architect's drawing. It could be a hand drawing. So I know there has been some concern raised that the requirement for a floor plan does require an architect's drawing. That is not the case. As at the scale of 1 to 50, it could be hand drawn, and you know it should be obviously an architect's. If it was a requirement, there was an architect's drawing, that does raise additional costs for an applicant, but there's no requirement that it has to be an architect's drawing in Glasgow. Yes, a floor plan is required, but a hand drawn, as long as it's able to show the room sizes, fire escapes, location of heat smoke alarms, to enable the consultees, the statutory consultees, to respond to the consultation satisfactorily.
That's helpful, thank you. Gary, do you have anything else to add around that guidance? And I know we've been asking individual councils for their view on this as well, to find out why this has been the case, that some are being told you need an architect's drawing.
No, I mean, our advice on it, thank you for your question, our advice on it is that whilst every effort should be made to submit professional plans, if they're unable to do it, hand-drawn plans will be acceptable, provided they're reasonably to scale or adequately dimensioned. And again, just as Gillian had said, we ask for those to include ideally a scale of 1 to 50, and we have certain things that are required. Again, we've taken a steer on that from our statutory consultees, so things such as fire escape routes, location of smoke and heat detectors, that type of thing. But no, we adopt a very pragmatic and common-sense approach. In the Highland Council, we have our STL licence in inbox and have asked a number of applicants to send on what they would propose as their floor plan. We can check that in advance of them making their application to give them some comfort that that's likely to be accepted or likely to be unaccepted in terms of marking that the application is valid. So we try to take a common sense, pragmatic approach, bearing in mind the feedback we've received from our statutory consultees and what they require on the floor plans.
That's helpful. Thank you for that. And just finally, I wanted to add or ask, with regards to other legislation impacts, we've recently just completed in Parliament's just passed the National Planning Framework 4. Policy 30E within that states, with regards to short-term lets, that the loss of residential accommodation where such a loss is not outweighed by demonstrable local economic benefits shouldn't be permitted. I just wondered what your interpretation of MPF 4 is also currently overlapping the short-term lets legislation as well. And maybe bring Gillian in and Gary if you've got anything to add as well.
Thank you very much for that. In relation to I'd be wary of answering in relation to the planning matters, given them licensing based. I think probably I can certainly speak to planning colleagues in relation to that specific point that you've raised, but I don't think it's in my remit, licensing based, to give an in-depth answer on that.
No problem. Gary, do you have anything you wanted to add?
I'm in the same position as Gillian. Sorry, I'm in the same position as Gillian, and that I would have to ask my planning colleagues to revert. Though I would just comment, you know, they are separate legislative. They are separate legislative frameworks, effectively.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks, Miles. I would like to just dig a little deeper in the scale drawings. And maybe, Rob, you could help us out because you're a part of this industry advisory group. So I have a sense you have a bit of an overview. So I'm wondering, are all local authorities requiring a scale drawing for their application? Do you know?
I don't know.
You don't
the
know
answer
that.
To that.
Okay. Does anybody know?
I think it's fairly standard, but I wouldn't say whether all of them are. But when I've been discussing it with people that have made applications, hand-drawn drawings seem to be acceptable in the same way that that Gary has said, that the cost of getting an architectural drawing can be expensive. But obviously some people will have floor plans if they've bought the house from the particulars, etc. So it doesn't seem to be an unusually onerous requirement for what is a business. And I think what perhaps we've steered away from this a wee bit during this conversation, but actually these are all businesses. You know, people are running them as businesses. If you've got one property or if you've got 100 properties, they are businesses, and this is a standard business requirement. And I suspect, without knowing too much about it, but actually if you were going to not require scale drawings or plans of any sort, then that would require visits and therefore the cost would go up. So I think the approach that councils are taking is very pragmatic and responsible, and saying we don't need to come out to see everybody, but actually you need to provide us with the same sort of level of information that any other business that is customer facing providing accommodation would have to supply. So mm-hmm. And I think this issue of local sort of distinctiveness between authorities is quite right, because I suspect what Gary might require in Highland Council would be very different from what the council would require in Edinburgh. So I suspect that local distinctiveness is nuanced, not an issue.
I'm just going to take my question a little bit further, because what I'm trying to understand is, I'm wondering if it's scale drawing that's creating confusion with people, and that's being interpreted as an architectural drawing, whereas, you know, people could get a piece of grid paper and, you know, use that box and that's their scale. And certainly when Gary said, you know, 1 to 50 would be nice, but it doesn't sound like exact. And it sounds to me like in the case of Highland Council, certainly, you don't need the, you know, down to the millimetre of the distance of the walls. It's a kind of general sense of the placement of things. Rob, you want to come back in?
Yeah, perhaps make a wider point and then come to the details. So the legislation has resulted in guidance being provided by the government to councils, and that guidance forms the basis on which the councils develop their policies and the practical application process. It's also the basis on which applicants look at how they are going to apply for a licence. As I indicated earlier, the time period in which the guidance was developed and councils then developed their policy was relatively short, and was during a period when perhaps some of the more detailed discussions, it was during COVID, etc., that might traditionally have taken place, I think probably didn't take place. And the result is that we haven't got here quite the level of specificity relating to this legislation that I would expect to see in the fullness of time, and I would have expected to have seen if trade associations, businesses, councils, and government, perhaps with COSLA in the mix as well, would have got to in developing the guidance. And the result of that is that councils understandably have drawn on their existing experience in relation to licensing regimes. They have in particular used HMO processes, housing and multiplication occupation processes. They in particular have used registered social landlord type experiences, and have arrived at policies and explanatory notes, which are there on individual websites, with the best of intentions. However, this is a regime for short-term lets. It is not a regime for houses in multiple occupation, and there therefore are differences. And I think what Gary and Gillian explained very clearly was the purpose of the drawing is to allow the statutory consultees, particularly, I think, probably Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, to see where the necessary fire equipment is. And it's that purpose which will be served by the drawings. We just need to refine the guidance, the explanatory notes, the processes in order that it all operates a little bit more effectively, with a little bit more ease, with a little less cost for everyone concerned, including the councils themselves, in order that it provides a licensing regime which ultimately is intended, as the government have said throughout, to be a proportionate risk-based approach. I think the sense from business is that they feel that some of the cost burden is not proportionate and it's not quite as risk-based as it would be. I'm trying very hard not to attribute fault to anybody. I don't think there is fault to be attributed to anybody. I think we've had to complete a set of processes in quite a compact time period, and there are improvements that could be made on all sides for the benefits of all.
OK, thanks for that. Although we've kind of known this has been coming for quite a long time, as Cliff laid out. Ilse, you want to come back in, and then I'm going to bring in Ruth McGuire.
It's just a very quick point. A lot of the discussion we have today, to me, would seem to be suitable for when we get to the review. So there's to be a review after 12, 18 months. And I think that's the point to consider a lot of these issues as to what's working and what's not working. And obviously, the longer we delay the implementation of the scheme, the longer it will be before we get to the review. So I think a lot of these issues would be much better dealt with rather than trying to work out that complete fine grain. And we know there is a lot of misinformation out there. Work out the fine grain now. Actually, let's get to the review and then see how well it's working and not working.
Thank you for that point.
Can I just support that? I just support that point that, you know, what we do know is that floor plans are required. That's part of the legislation. The question you're looking at is whether those floor plans should be required by the 1st of April in a licensing system or by the 1st of October. And there's ample opportunity to adapt once we know how the system is working. But the basic requirement is there. Mm. And if it makes sense to have floor plans in October, it makes sense to have floor plans in April. I'd also just, if I just pick up one point that was raised by Miles around the MPF4 and so on and the economic benefit. I think we see some of the difficulty in what the Festivals Edinburgh is saying. So, for example, you know, they've said that 700 jobs will be lost. So that's the economic cost of it, right? One question, you know, how many of those jobs are full-time? How many are temporary? How many are paying above the national minimum wage? And also, you know, does anybody know what 700 jobs is as a percentage of the total number of jobs in Edinburgh? Let me tell you, 0.002%, OK? Now, if you say 700 jobs going to go, wow! You know, if you say 0.02% of the jobs in Edinburgh are going to go so that we can reclaim some housing, it's a different sort of picture. Mm-hmm. Similarly, I think the gap between how affordable short-term lets are and hotels are, I think we need to just be careful on that, because we know last summer one complaint was that the fringe had become very unaffordable. Now, accommodation is one part of the cost that people face, but there's also costs of room hire, there's also costs of publicity, of travel subsistence, etc. So we mustn't overstate the significance. And I just checked yesterday. At the moment, you can book Holiday Inn Express for 6 nights in mid-August in Edinburgh for one adult for £1,419. Or I could book a one-bedroom flat on Airbnb in central Edinburgh for those same 6 nights as advertised on Airbnb for £1,345. So there's about £70 difference, you know, £10 a day, basically, the difference. So, you know, I think we can't assume that just if you reduce the supply of Airbnb, that actually, you know, destroys the affordability that's there at the moment. Similarly, I think the Fringe argued that they need about 25,000 bed nights during August, or that short-term lets provide them. But at 90% occupancy, which is what the hotels achieved the last year we got data before COVID, 2019, there was still 10% available at that point, right? That's about 50,000 bed nights. So if you filled the hotels to full capacity, I know this is a bit hypothetical, but I'm just saying, you know, it's not as that the economic case is not as watertight as it might appear. Whether you look at the scale of the economy, the temporary nature of the events, the alternatives, and really the challenge is to find different ways to run these major events that create a peak, and look at ways that you can spread that peak through the year, which will sustain lots more businesses in the city than having a pop-up stall that appears in Princess Street Gardens or whatever for 4 weeks.
Thank you for that, Cliff. Ruth.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I appreciate what both Ailsa and Cliff were saying there, and I think particularly in terms of sustainability around jobs and homes. That said, I am going to drill in a bit further on what Rob was talking there about the guidance. My understanding is that the committee's received written evidence arguing that some local authorities are applying conditions to short-term licences out with the scope of the legislation. So I'd be interested to hear Rob's further reflections on that, if he understands that to be correct and what the implications of that are. After that, I'd like to hear from the officers from Highland Council and Glasgow City Council, specifically if they've applied any additional conditions, and if so, what they are and what they set out to address. Thanks, Convener.
Maybe try and make 3 points in relation to that. I want to re-emphasise the importance of the policies made by each council being appropriate for each council. It's clearly not the case that the policies that would be adopted in Edinburgh would be appropriate, for example, in the Scottish Borders. And I think, therefore, the strength in this legislation is that it is for individual councils to adopt their individual policies and to their best place to understand the nuances of what is required in an individual area. However, there are certainly assertions from operators and from some of the trade bodies within the sector that the scope of the policies have been drawn too widely or are extending beyond the remit of the short-term lets regulations. I am not a lawyer and I'm probably ill-equipped to say whether that is the case or not. But I think what you can see is a set of issues seeking to be addressed which councils believe are relevant in the context of short-term lets. Now, whether it falls within the legal remit of the legislation or not, I would leave for lawyers and I guess ultimately the courts to decide. But I think the importance of getting that local policy to be framed correctly, to be appropriate in local circumstances, cannot be overstated. My final point relates to the earlier comments I made, which is, and then the guidance and the explanation of how people actually meet the application process and follow that is also important, because it needs to be made as straightforward and as easy as possible. I think, as Ailsa said, there are examples of where that has happened, but there are also examples, I think, where applicants have found the process is quite difficult in relation to what has to be done.
Thank you. That's helpful. Convener, if I could go to, forgive me, Gillian, please.
Thank you very much. The council does have additional conditions. These relate to noise, nuisance and littering, and they were drafted in line with the Scottish Government's guidance to licensing authorities. In the consultation that was undertaken in relation to the short-term let policy, which detailed style additional conditions, there were two conditions that were subsequently removed on the back of the consultation, and these conditions related to the key safe and restricting the hours of comings and goings of guests arriving. Those conditions, the key safe and the timings, were removed on the back of the consultation. The other additional conditions, noise, nuisance and littering, as per the Scottish Government guidance, while there were, I wouldn't say everybody was happy with them in the consultation, but the majority didn't have too big concerns in relation to those conditions, and I suspect it's because it was in line with the Scottish Government guidance to licensing authorities.
Thank you. And Gary, for Highland Council, any additional conditions?
Yes, so again, echoing some of what Gillian said, so again, in line with the Scottish Government guidance to licensing authorities and following discussions with stakeholders and the Highland Licensing Committee, we included the additional conditions to reflect the practical realities for short-term let properties and the wider policy objectives of the licensing scheme. Now, again, our additional conditions are not intended to be onerous for licence holders, and indeed we have not received any specific concerns or complaints regarding those. We have not included prescriptive steps within our additional conditions. So, for example, there is no prescriptive steps regarding equipment safety or the installation of carpets in place of hard flooring, which is a question we understand that has been put out there as to whether that is something that has to be done as a prescriptive step. We have instead included conditions that state that the licence holder has to take reasonable steps in terms of privacy and security, littering and waste disposal, and the use and maintenance of hot tubs. And again, we have some discretionary additional conditions which can be applied on the back of noise complaints, etc. They are not applied as standard and only where required. So that we take a very, as I said earlier about floor plans, we take a pragmatic approach, and I think our additional licensing conditions are common sense, and I've got to say, I think what a lot of people would be doing anyway. And we also have conditions, other additional conditions that you would expect to see, such as that they have to tell us if there's a material change of circumstances, and report in certain instances in terms of structural damage or collapse or gas leak, fire, explosion, that type of thing. So again, very pragmatic approach.
Thank you. We've heard, and it's about the impact occasionally of these short-term lets. I think someone else described them as party flats. Just looking at your condition around noise there, you said that that's not automatically in. What would trigger a condition around noise? What would that look like? I'm thinking of the perspective of neighbours, perhaps, that have one of these properties next to them.
So we have additional conditions regarding noise and antisocial behaviour, which will apply regardless, and that is to say that the licence holder will take reasonable steps to ensure no disturbance or nuisance arises within or from the property, for example, by explaining the house rules to the guests, to deal effectively with any disturbance or nuisance arising within or from the property as soon as reasonably practicable after the licence holder is made aware of it, and to ensure that any vehicles belonging to guests are parked lawfully. So, for example, explaining where any designated parking spaces are found and highlighting any local rules. In terms of the, so that applies as a standard additional condition. If there are steps which have been identified following investigations by the Highland Council's environmental health team, then if the use of the condition is deemed appropriate and proportionate for the specific use by enforcement officers who are following the enforcement policy for environmental health, then that's where your additional conditions regarding noise could come into play. And that could be, for example, the licence holders to take steps to ensure the noise monitor equipment is maintained in full working order, or it could be a condition that that there can't be noise between certain decibels between 7 a.m. and 11 p.m. Or certain decibels between 11 p.m. and 7 a.m. And it could be that there's the licence holder to take reasonable steps to ensure that guests do not use the hot tub after 10 p.m. Again, that would be applied following investigation of concerns regarding noise associated with hot tubs and where a hot tub is positioned in close proximity or overlooked by neighbouring properties. So that's a kind of example. Full details are on our website. I'm happy to provide a list of those. But as I say, we have effectively general noise and antisocial behaviour additional conditions which will apply for every licence. And then if there were specific case-by-case investigations from the Council's Environmental Health Team, then those additional conditions regarding noise would be applied.
Thank you. That's helpful. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Ruth. Okay, we're coming to our last couple of questions, and they're coming from Mark Griffin, who's joining us online.
Thanks, Convener. The committee's heard, or we've had written evidence with concerns that licence application process can be unduly complex. Some people have talked about poorly designed online application processes, although I know that Ailsa Rayburn in our evidence earlier has said that she's aware of people who have found it fairly simple and easy to complete. But I wonder if I could come to Gary first and just ask how he would respond to concerns that the application process is unduly complex, and perhaps reflect on how he would view the process in comparison to other application processes and the authority for other licensing functions.
Thank you, Mark. The Highland Council spent a significant time and resource putting in place the staff and the training and the processes which were necessary to deal with the anticipated number of applications and inquiries from prospective applicants. And with that in mind, we developed an online process which allows applicants to answer the questions and only effectively asks them the follow-up questions which are relevant to their application. It has branch questions, so we're only asking the questions that are relevant and we're not asking irrelevant questions. We have received, if in the event that the applicant does not have online access, we offer digital assistance by way of attending one of our council service centres, and one of our admin or licensing officers can effectively assist in that regard. We've received mostly positive feedback today on our online application form, and I've got to say at the other end of it, from our staff, we are processing the application forms, and that appears to be working well and efficiently. We have used this as an opportunity to get our online system up and running for it, and we are, as I say, using that online system to process these applications. I think that the number that we have, which as I said was 809, the number that we have and the way in which we're processing those today, I think has allowed us to get up and running, so that now when we get what we're anticipating is the big remaining flood of applications over the next short while, then I think we have got the good processes in place and we're effectively ready for those applications to come in. So yes, no, I'm really pleased with how our processes are running, and as I say, we do receive mostly positive feedback on that.
Okay, thanks for that. Gillian, did you have any comments on a Glasgow perspective on any concerns around the application process?
Yeah, thank you very much for your question. In relation to the licensing process for short-term lets in Glasgow, similar to Highlands, we have an online application form. And it does trigger by what your answers are, other questions may appear or may not appear. In relation to the feedback, we do get for a variety of licence applications in Glasgow, people are very open and honest if they're finding an application form difficult, and will try and take the feedback and adapt a form within reason where we can. For short-term lets, we've not had any concerns raised about the online form from the applications that have been received to date or people that have potentially looked at it. It's an application form that you can save as you go along, so you don't have to complete it in one go. So I think from Glasgow's perspective, I think so far it's been a positive experience in relation to the application process.
Okay, thanks for that. My second question, Camilla, was around concerns that we've heard from local authorities and public sector partners who are involved in the application process, like Scottish Fire and Rescue, about them not having the necessary resources to process applications quickly enough. And I know, Gary, you touched on this essentially about the profiling of spend on staff perhaps now being out of sync, but with a potential 6-month delay. And I just wonder, again, coming to Gillian first, then Gary, about how your authorities are managing to cover costs just now, and whether that's something that the government should be looking at if they plan on implementing a 6-month delay, which then has a knock-on impact on the income that you would expect to receive to cover those costs.
Yeah, thank you very much for your question. In relation to the costs for the implementation, when Glasgow City Council looked at the proposed fees that did go out for a public consultation, the fees were determined in line with the business and regulatory impact assessment from the Scottish Government and the Scottish Government guidance. On a cost recovery basis, the fees were set. So, from Glasgow's perspective, the fees that are set, I don't foresee any difficulty with fees that are set in relation to any proposed extension that's possibly given here. Glasgow, in relation to the processing, we did pay money for a system, an online system for the applications, but the resources in relation to staff are currently absorbed within the licensing section anyway. We've not taken on additional staff for the processing of short-term lets.
Thanks. And Gary?
Yes, as I think we had detailed in our written submission, the committee, we have taken on quite a number of staff in order to process the STL licensing applications, and I think I detailed those earlier, both in our legal team and in our environmental health team. Those roles were appointed on the basis of the existing deadlines within the short-term legislation, and indeed we have put quite a bit of time and resources into having our processes ready and up and running on the basis of those existing timelines. And I earlier had mentioned about the fixed term nature of some of the appointments and the implication that will have. The other impact is the proposed delay has already led staff who are on the fixed term contracts to raise concerns regarding the impact that has on their immediate employment. And while we've sought to reassure them of their current position on the basis of the number of applications which we've received to date and in which we continue to receive, we completely appreciate why the employees are raising these concerns, and due to the material reduction in projected income, indeed I've got to say we share their concerns. So the proposed extension does have significant resource implications for the Highland Council, and as I said in our written submission, we would request that the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee provide funding to cover the financial burden that we all now incur as a direct impact of the proposed delay. That will enable us to address the resource implications and, for example, allow us to fund an extension of these fixed-term appointments so that we have these members of staff in place effectively to process and deal with the bulk of applications when we need them the most.
Okay, thanks for that. I'll hand back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mark, and thank you, Gary. Just to let you know, the committee doesn't have a budget to provide you, but we totally take on board the significant resource implications, and that you had done a good job to set up in the timescale that had been outlined, and that sounds like it was tremendous work done there, and so definitely taking note of that. I think we've come to the end of our questioning for this morning, and apologies for running a bit over, but that was the direction of travel we went in. So I'd like to thank the witnesses this morning for the evidence, and I now suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. For our second panel today, we are joined in person by Julia Amour, who's the Director of Festivals Edinburgh, and online we're joined by Fiona Campbell, Chief Executive of the Association of Scotland Self-Caterers. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting, and I'm going to open with questions. I'll direct this to you, Julia, just so you know it's coming to you first. The regulations under consideration provide for a six-month delay to the date by which existing hosts must have submitted an application for a short-term let licence. Could you set out your view of this delay and its potential implications?
Yes, thank you. Thank you for inviting us to give evidence this morning. I represent Festivals Edinburgh, which is the 11 major international festival organisations in the main charities that underpin the organisation of festivals in Edinburgh. There's also, as members of the committee will know, a whole kind of hinterland of individual festival organisers behind that. So you've also had some evidence from some of the major venues in the city who make up the whole landscape of the Fringe and the other festivals that happen in peak season and beyond. So my evidence is based on the views of the directors of Festivals Edinburgh Limited, and in that respect we've been talking about short-term lets and supporting the existence of regulation for short-term lets in the city since 2018, and in cognizance of the fact that there are some areas of high concentration and that there are some neighbourhood amenity issues that need to be addressed. But the committee has heard this morning that it has been a very long process, but it's also been a complex process and a disrupted process, not only by the local authority elections last year that Rob from Visit Scotland referred to, but also by COVID and by all of the contingencies of COVID. And the festivals have not emerged from that unscathed at all. So the festivals are 75% of the scale in 2022 that they were in 2019. And I think that's an example of the kind of cost of living pressures, post-COVID pressures that mean that we welcome this delay to the implementation of the legislation on licensing, because it gives time for that clarity to emerge that's been talked about already this morning. That clarity for people using the legislation, and that clarity across local authorities about how the interpretation and the implementation of the legislation has gone. If a blanket approach is taken, it would really damage jobs and livelihoods without achieving some of the policy's key aims. And we don't want the licensing scheme to be gone, but firstly, we do want it put beyond doubt that brief periods of stays in residents' personal private homes for major festival events should be out of scope. And that could be done with a national exclusion, as is done elsewhere in the legislation for homestay students who have an arrangement with an educational institution. That is the key point of interpretation of the legislation that we want to bring forward to say, surely that is a relatively uncontroversial point, that personally primary letting is different from secondary letting, and that there should be a balanced approach to these two parts. It's not all of the story, and you've heard that from the Fringe venues, and you'll hear that from the Self-Caterers Association, I'm sure, but surely that's a point where there could be relatively clear agreement and clarity established to improve the implementation of these legislation requirements. Secondly, we think that extra time is needed for all local authorities to have that proper evidence and impact assessment to model both the positive and negative effects of regulation for all types of short-term lets, because the implementation of the policies will have very wide-ranging consequences, and those will differ across the country. So it's quite right that different local authorities have the ability to act in different ways. But we think happy to expand further on those and other points. But those are the two key points that we're coming forward with today, that primary personal letting is different, and it needs to be clarified that the short, brief periods in people's own homes can be lightened up, and that impact assessment and evidence is really important to be in place before wide-ranging decisions are taken about all sorts of aspects of the short-term letting system.
Thanks very much for that. Fiona?
Good morning. Thanks so much indeed for giving us this opportunity to join you this morning, and we absolutely welcome this additional scrutiny because it's very much required. Apologies, I'm not with you. I'm actually on holiday and I'm in a hotel, so apologies in advance if there is any untoward noise. I've tried to get away from as much as possible. Just a general observation I'd like to make in the interim. Slightly disappointed that the conversation this morning has been hugely conflated between housing pressure and licensing, which is about the safety of an activity. I was under the impression this was about the licensing under the Civic Government Act 1982 rather than the planning situation, which, as Gillian McNaught quite rightly said, is a very different thing. So I just like to make that observation in the first instance. But going back to the question and the delay, it is absolutely critical that there's a delay at this point, because fundamentally, as our evidence has shown, the legislation as it has been laid is flawed, and it is hugely damaging to a sector in Scotland. The self-catering sector alone represents £867 million to the Scottish economy. In addition to that, you've got bed and breakfast, guest houses and so on and so forth, that this is hugely affecting. But it's not just affecting our premises and our properties and our incomes and our legitimate livelihoods. It's also affecting attractions, hospitality sector widely, which we spend an awful lot of money in all over the country. It's having an impact on investment organisations. It's having a huge impact on brokers. People can't buy, people can't sell. I think that we've given absolute evidence as to why this isn't working, and we absolutely can find a solution. I think this is a great opportunity to do that, but this delay is incredibly welcome and incredibly necessary in order to find that right solution. And just to highlight that when the letter came from the Cabinet Secretary on the 7th of December, people stopped applying and opened their calendars. So it's just kind of really important that we all reflect on the fact that calendars are now open, and that will have an effect on whether or not we can honour those bookings. So I would also just like to reflect on the point that one of the committee members has said that short-term lets are party flats. We are not party flats. We are professional, legitimate businesses with legitimate livelihoods, and those livelihoods need to be protected. But really happy to work with the committee to find a way through this.
Thanks, Fiona. Just for clarity, I think that the purpose of this evidence that we're taking today is just to look at the delay, and we're not looking at changing the legislation in any way, shape or form. So just to be clear on that. I'd be interested to hear, and again, I'll start with you, Julia, what evidence there is, if you are aware of it, that the short-term licensing regime is adversely affecting Scotland's tourist economy, or do you think it's too early to tell?
Obviously, because we haven't got close to the deadline yet, there isn't firm evidence about what the behaviour of the industry will be. However, you will have received evidence from some of the major fringe venues on a survey that was done in Edinburgh last autumn, where I think over 300 operators of properties that they use replied. And the result of that survey suggested that under 10% of those accommodation providers expected to be able to make their accommodation available under the current coming regime that the City of Edinburgh Council is looking at on both licensing and planning fronts. And that is something that one of the previous witnesses noted, is that in Edinburgh, the planning provisions are planned to come in on stream at the same time as the licensing provisions. So it's difficult to disentangle the effects that those two things are having. The Fringe Society, which is the small charity that kind of coordinates the wishes of individual arts companies and venues to perform at the Fringe, took a slightly less, slightly more benign view, slightly more conservative view, that perhaps 50% of activity might be prevented by people being unable to get accommodation. And it is the biggest single thing that people say to us is a barrier to coming to Edinburgh in August, is the accommodation cost. And but even if it's only 50% of reduction in supply for that peak season where you need a surge of temporary supply. That amounts to a third of the Fringes programme. So on a, in addition to the programme being smaller in 2022 and having bounced back, I think, very successfully, but at a smaller scale post-COVID, this could result in a further drop of 30 to 50% in the scale of what's able to happen in Edinburgh in August. Now, you know, there might be some people who feel that it could be an attractive idea for the Fringe to resize. However, this is not a managed consolidation. This is an economic shock, and that economic shock would not simply have the effect of reducing the numbers of shows and the numbers of workers. Cliff may have feel that that isolated figure of 700 jobs is not a large figure, but it is the start of a downward spiral. And the spiral is the fewer shows, the fewer reviewers, the fewer bookers of work, the fewer audiences. And in a few small years, you know, Scotland has lost a unique part of its intangible cultural heritage. So I don't think this is simply an Edinburgh issue. And I think that the impacts, although they are not able to be fully known yet, the leading indicators are showing that that is a real risk. So one of the largest assembly venues on the Fringe Assembly has said that producers are bringing about 50% of the work that they were bringing previously. So these are not these leading indicators are not, you know, simply false flags. The effect is starting to happen.
Thank you for that. Fiona, do you have a sense of the impact?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm welcome to Julia's comments about the wider impact on the economy and so on and so forth, which we won't know until like further down the line. But this is actually having an impact on small businesses and accommodation providers right now. So we are talking about additional costs associated with licensing. Now, yes, we already complied with existing health and safety legislation, but additional requirements have been added, such as the requirement for EICRs and PAT testing. That requires people to go out and do those for you. As we've already heard today, people are finding that incredibly difficult, specifically in islands and rural locations, to find service providers and tradesmen. The cost of living crisis, difference in behaviour of guests at the moment, people are not booking in the same way that they did do previously. You know, the bookings are patchy. We don't have the income to pay for this front-loaded expenditure. You've got also, we've heard a lot about layout plans, which I'm very happy to go into detail about, because it's a really significant issue. They cost a lot of money. You can't just do it on a piece of graph paper. Then there's the planning. There's a planning consideration that's been shoehorned in at Schedule 3, Section 13, that is a real issue and is causing huge amounts of concern to small operators where it's never been there before. And then you've got these extraordinary fees across Scotland, which do not fit within the BREEA's aspirations of £214 to £436. There's huge amounts of uncertainty. The additional conditions in some areas are absolutely extraordinary and ultra vires to the legislation. All of this is meaning that it's incredibly difficult, incredibly damaging and stressful for small accommodations. It's disproportionate and it's gone beyond the scope of the legislation. So people are realistically, in real time, giving up their businesses and their livelihoods. Small B&Bs that operated for decades are closing because this is too much. It's too much and it's unnecessary. And we're seeing it left, right and centre. People are leaving the sector in droves. Self-caterers are selling their businesses and they're being bought by second homeowners. This is going to exacerbate the second home problem. This is not going to help housing.
Okay. I think you stopped there rather than got cut off. All right, thank you very much for that. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with a few questions.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. And my questions were really for Fiona, but we're kind of touching on the issues at the moment. Fiona, it was to give you an opportunity on the record to share with the committee what you felt were the unintended consequences of the licensing scheme. And you've touched on a few there that you've mentioned. So I wonder if you could just to complete that offering so that we get it on the record? What are the other areas of concern that you might have in relation to unintended consequences of the scheme?
Thanks very much indeed. But I think, you know, I'm not going to repeat a rather substantive evidence that we've already submitted as written evidence, because that kind of exemplifies all of the detail. But the unintended consequences include anything from the wide range of discrepancies across local authority areas, whether you're in the Western Isles or the borders, they're completely different requirements. You've got the ultra vires policies in some places, the additional conditions around carpeting, around the requirement for additional cutlery space in Dundee City. And in Argyll and Bute and Aberdeenshire, they've added an additional condition around boat and bike hire, which has nothing to do with the provision of accommodation. Then you've got the planning considerations. Those are the really big unintended consequences. And if you look at the committee session from South Ayrshire on the 15th of December, the complication around this additional consideration around planning has really confused licensing authorities. As Gillian says, they're two completely different regimes, but they're being conflated, and one regime is being used to confuse another regime. It's not working, and it's causing a huge amount of stress. The planning element is probably one of the biggest threats in amongst all of this, and licensing authorities clearly don't understand the requirement. Again, I'll refer you to that 15th of December meeting in South Ayrshire. Then the bigger, really big block is the investment barrier. Lenders will not lend on the basis of this licensing legislation. They simply will not do that. We have had that in writing from two of the biggest lenders in the country. It's also affecting small local brokers that depend on this for their own livelihoods. They simply cannot find the lending in order to support people, whether that's buying new properties or whether it's investing in your properties. If you need a new roof, for example, people are not going to lend to you. You then can't sell your property under the current regime either. So you've got a complete barrier to both sell and buy, and therefore you can't even exit the sector now. This is a huge problem. Then, of course, there's the booking problem. People are not booking, because why would you book a property if the owner will not necessarily be able to honour that booking? Lots of people in our sector book up a year and a half in advance. If I'm not sure that you're going to be able to honour that booking on the basis of licensing application, you're not going to book. You're going to go elsewhere. So this is meaning this is really happening, and people are moving and going to stay in England instead. We don't want that as a nation, do we? So, you know, I won't go into the detail. It's in our written evidence, but I'm happy to expand on any of those points.
Thanks very much for that. I wonder if you heard the previous session we had there, where my learned colleague on floor plans sitting beside me asked the question. But Glasgow and Highland, I think, said that hand drawings and layout plans are acceptable, and talked about scale of 1 to 50. So what do you say to that evidence that they provided, and bearing in mind what you just said yourself, that these could cost a lot of money and you can't do it on a piece of graph paper? It seems to be two different points of view there.
Absolutely. So if you speak to the official that actually pulled the legislation together, and I have done so, the requirement for plans is to evidence maximum occupancy, nothing more, nothing less. It's to say, if you've got a 5-bedroom house, that you sleep 10. If I say I've got a 5-bedroom house and I sleep 42, you might want to give me a call and ask how that happens. But the requirement for plans was simply for the maximum occupancy element of the licensing. It is not for fire provision. Scottish Fire and Rescue Service does not require plans. They simply do not require it. Nobody else needs plans. Highland Council is asking for a site plan. That's planning. That's not licensing. Licensing isn't about the health and safety of the activity. So that's why you don't need the layout plans. The statutory consultees do not require it as per this legislation. They would require it for Licensing Act 2005, yes. They may require something else for HMO licensing, but the problem we're finding is different local authorities are pulling in different legislative regimes and conflating them all and gold-plating it and asking for all sorts of things that simply aren't required. Now, going back to the realities of what it costs, officials again said that we were possibly overstating that it costs £600 plus VAT to deliver a plan to 1 to 50. Well, unfortunately, that's not true because I've got the invoice. I've paid it. That's what it costs. You cannot do this to scale realistically, appropriately. And if we go back to the beginning, this is about maximum occupancy. If you've got a 5-bedroom house and you sleep 10, that should be adequate.
Okay, thank you very much for putting all of that on the record. Julia, do you have any comments to throw into the mix on that subject of unintended consequences?
Yeah, it would be good to come back on unintended consequences. Thank you, because right. I do think that comes to the heart of the point about temporary exemptions for up to 6 weeks and how that was written into the legislation as a mechanism to account for the kind of surge demand that you need to put in place if you're going to be Scotland the perfect stage, if you're going to stage major events, whether in Edinburgh in peak seasons or in other bits of the country, as Rob was referring to. And the way that that provision's been drawn up has been interpreted differently across the country. And although the Cabinet Secretary has said that it wasn't intended that that provision should lead to mandatory and additional conditions necessarily being required for people who are letting out in different circumstances, including homestays and going on holiday and letting out their house for short periods of time. That is what has happened in Edinburgh, is that almost all of the same conditions with the same costs are being required of people who simply want a very short-term ability to let their home out, which they would be able to do if they were hosting an exchange student, for example, or which they would be able to do if they were hosting a longer term lodger. So I guess that's an unintended consequence, that I think the longer lead time in to people making their applications is required to get further clarity on that from the national level about what was the policy intention of that and how can that properly be enacted.
Okay, thank you. Thank you both for that. I just have another question that's probably only for Fiona. Fiona, you're saying in your submission that you would like to see a review of the licensing scheme immediately, now, rather than wait until the system is perhaps fully embedded, perhaps in 12, 18 months' time, I think was mentioned during the initial session. Why would you be calling for the review immediately at this stage before the scheme has had a chance to bed in?
I mean, this is an opportunity to review it from the ground up because it's clearly not working and we've evidenced that. This is a different meaning of review. This is not what has happened. This is, we're already seeing that this is not working. So how can we review it to make it better so that it is fit for purpose? So rather than looking at, you know, there's no point in waiting to see how many people have left the sector because it's been usually damaging and reflecting on that, we need to protect businesses. And as the First Minister said at the Business and Parliament reception on Thursday, it is incumbent on the Scottish Government to protect and support businesses through this incredibly difficult time. This legislation is damaging it hugely. And again, I'll say this is legitimate businesses. This is people's livelihoods. This is not Airbnb. This is not party flats. This is legitimate businesses that are really, this is causing a huge amount of pain to. So it seems to me that this is a fantastic opportunity during this delay to look at this, even if it's the guidance, to make sure that it becomes fit for purpose. These trains are going off track. We need to get them back on track as soon as possible because this is impacting people today. People are leaving the sector today.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Fiona. Julia, do you have anything to add to the sense of whether we should review now, later, abandon, continue with the scheme?
It's evident that we will not find out the full scope of this until further down the track, but we also have to take account of some leading indicators. So I do think that the opportunity of more time to see the implementation of the legislation done in a consistent and smooth way and to to look at whether there are aspects that are not having the effect that was intended is really, really important. I don't have the policy prescription as to whether that's a review or looking at keeping the timing under review until all of these anomalies have been properly discussed and sorted out. But it has indeed been a long time in the gestation, but it is also very complex and wide-ranging legislation that has national aspects and local aspects, and affects a sector which accounts for, I think, about, well, between tourism and creative industries, it's about 12% of employment across Scotland, and it's the same across Edinburgh. So, again, I don't dispute what the Coburn Association say about health and education being very important sectors in Edinburgh, but arts and recreation and the visitor economy between them account for 44,000 workers in the city, which is more than finance and more than education. So this is a very important sector that we need to look carefully at big changes.
Okay. Thank you both very much for your contributions there. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Willie. I'm now going to bring in Paul McClellan.
Thanks, Convener. And morning, Julia. The question is really for yourself. This is around about, I think you've mentioned about, highlighted concerns about the system that governs temporary exemptions at this stage, and obviously we've heard obviously the impact that would have on the festival, and we've obviously seen your evidence has come forward. I just wonder if you can give a little bit more around about how you think that could be overcome in terms of that, in your own opinion. And I suppose the other issue, just kind of slightly related, which is another question, is talking about home sharing and so on as well at that particular time, obviously, which is an element during the festival. I don't know if you can just comment on these 2 points.
Yeah, of course, because home sharing and home letting, it is part of that intangible cultural heritage. It has been since 1947 when the festivals started up. You know, the fact that there was a mingling between Scottish culture and world cultures, and that people hosted people in their homes is part of what makes Edinburgh so special on a global scale at that time of year. So I think it would be very damaging if that was deterred. I think there is evidence, not quantitative evidence, but certainly plenty of anecdotal evidence that people who choose to do that for a few weeks, not every year, when it suits them, would be deterred by a scheme that expects them to tick all the same boxes as a scheme where people are letting out all year round. And we've certainly heard plenty of people who've said that they would not be continuing that under those circumstances. And there's also a sort of local wealth building aspect to this as well, because the further we get into the cost of living crisis, the more people are looking to afford their own homes in a way that might have become unaffordable to them. We actually spoke to the Cyrenians, the local homeless charity, about that, and they agreed that home letting and home sharing was a good way for people to be able to maybe manage their costs in an expensive city like Edinburgh. So it's an important part of the culture, but it has a resonance beyond Edinburgh, because Edinburgh's festivals is something that Scotland is known for around the world, and is a cornerstone of our whole visitor economy. So I think it is important to get this right. And at the moment, there's a mismatch between what the legislation was designed to do in terms of temporary exemptions, which was designed to be able to let people do that kind of very temporary house sharing or house letting without as heavy a touch as 365 days a year. But that's not the way that it's working in practice. So to me, the simplest thing, I'm not the policymaker, but to me, the simplest thing would be to look to the exclusion that's already in the Act, which is an exclusion for homestay students for educational purposes, and whether there could be a clarification that kind of exclusion can also be adapted for major festivals and events.
Yeah, I mean, it's all in me of the Scottish Open, thankfully, every year. And you know, the home sharing and house letting is an issue that comes up every year in East Lothian. So very, very issues that are there. No, thanks for that. I suppose, in a broader, and this is opening it up to yourself and Fiona, is in terms of when you look at the licensing scheme, we've kind of talked about it being a barrier onto the short-term letting market. And Fiona, you've already touched on that one. I don't know if you want to come in on that one a little bit more. And again, you've already touched on this about the licence scheme being applied inconsistently. Probably more to Fiona. Julie, I don't know if you've anything on these two particular issues that you've got feedback in terms of that you've been speaking to people within, but this is maybe more aimed at Fiona as well, but have you any comments or thoughts?
Fiona obviously works in the industry, whereas we're a kind of user of the industry, so I defer to Fiona.
Fiona?
Thanks very much. There's kind of a whole pile of things to unpack there. And with all due respect to colleagues at Festivals Edinburgh, and Edinburgh is incredibly critical to our nation, but, you know, a lot of this is a very Edinburgh-centric conversation, and we've got to remember that this covers the whole of Scotland, our rural areas, our islands, and so on and so forth. None of the conversations that we're having today really help my 87-year-old member that's been a self-caterer for 43 years with no problems, that lives in Sutherland and is going to have to get a taxi to Inverness in order to complete his online application because there's no paper equivalent. It's also not going to affect my 47-year-old member who is suffering a degenerative disease in Edinburgh and has had to sell their property because they're simply not going to be able to get planning or a licence due to the rebuttable presumption. It's not going to help the 60-year-old member from Cumbrae, who's been a carer for 10 years and her husband very sadly just died. She doesn't know what to do because she doesn't think she's going to be able to get through these licensing hoops. You know, we've got to remember this is real people and real people's livelihoods. And it's also, you're absolutely right, people in the middle of a cost of living crisis want to use their properties, their asset, their property, in order to get some augmented income to cover the mortgage fees. You know, and they're not going to be able to jump through these hoops and these additional conditions, especially in Edinburgh, due to the cost associated with that. And whilst, for example, in Glasgow, you're talking about fees, whilst in Glasgow, you're right, they have kept their fees relatively low. They're not going to give very many licences out because they're simply not going to meet the conditions of planning and licensing in Glasgow. But actually, if you look at the fees across the board, Perth and Kinross goes up to £1,600. Dundee City goes up to £3,100. Edinburgh goes up to £5,869 for a one-year licence for the larger properties. This is not insignificant amounts of money. Now, if you go back to this morning's evidence and Elsa Raeburn and said there was it was great because there's a parity with PRT. There is no parity with PRT here. If you have parity with PRT, which covers exactly the same health and safety legislation, that costs £68 for the landlord plus £14 per property for a three-year private PRT registration. That's under £100. So I would ask the committee if they think that it's appropriate that if you're a private landlord, it's going to cost you £100, but if you're a self-caterer and you're being assessed on exactly the same health and safety criteria, it would cost you any more than £100. It doesn't seem to make any sense.
Fiona, just one point. I'm conscious of time. You mentioned obviously before about discussions about being conflated between control areas and the licensing. I don't know if you want to add any more on that. You kind of touched on that in your introduction or in the first question. I don't know if you want to touch any more on that because I think, again, evidence I've probably seen from constituents is in terms of that it's almost like its planning's been conflated as well as the licensing kind of issue. So I don't know if you want to say any more on that, just in your own view.
Yeah. You're absolutely right. Planning has become one of the biggest threats now to our sector. So in Schedule 3 of legislation, point 13, the planning permission, where the premises is in a short-term let control area for the purposes of the Town and Country Planning Act, the holder of the licence must, where the use of the premises for a short-term let requires planning permission, ensure that they do so or they will have. But if you then go to South Ayrshire, for example, the licence condition is that people will have to clarify either whether they do not require planning permission or they do require it and have the permission to do so as part of that licensing consideration. That's not what the legislation says, but that's how the local authority has interpreted it. And so you've got this disparity between different local authorities. Argyll and Bute is not asking for planning permission unless there is a planning control area or there has been a material change of use. Now, clearly, where there is a material change of use, you will always require planning permission. But we have to be very careful that we're now not looking at applying retrospective planning permission requirements to businesses that have invested heavily for a number of years, whether that's 2 years, 5 years, 10 years or 20 years, because it's suddenly been conflated with a licensing scheme. They're two completely different regimes and they need to be looked at with completely different eyes. But that's impossible given point 13 of Schedule 3.
Thanks, Fiona. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much, Paul. I'm going to bring in Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for joining us today. Sorry for disturbing your holiday as well, Fiona. I was wondering where that painting was, maybe in the Highlands behind you, to be honest. But I wanted to ask a couple of questions which we've touched upon already, but I raised earlier with regards to the National Planning Framework and specifically guidance, because I think this is another piece of legislation we will want to look at, how guidance then filters down to councils and how it's interpreted. So I just wondered where currently your understanding of policy 30E is being interpreted. I'll maybe bring you in, Fiona, and then Julia, if you've got anything to add.
Thanks, Miles. You know, you're absolutely right. When we submitted our consultation application to the MPF for consultation, we reference 30E because it has a real problem. It's an overarching policy which feeds into different planning policies and local development plans. And whilst some local authorities will not use it and they will just shelve it and it's not relevant, which we welcome, other local authorities such as Edinburgh will start using it immediately. Now, the issue is that that particular policy says that you will have to evidence that the benefit of being a short-term let outweighs any residential benefit. Now, that becomes incredibly, incredibly subjective. Now, City of Edinburgh Council Planning Authority has already written to every single outstanding planning application, of which there are several hundred, which they have waited for MPF 4 to come out, perhaps, allegedly, possibly, to say that applicants will now need to evidence that benefit. Now, that has an ongoing effect on all sorts of rural businesses, agritourism businesses particularly, because part of that policy is also that you need to evidence you've got good transport links. Well, we've all been to rural parts of the Highlands. They do not have good transport links. So does that mean that we would not get planning permission? We've just got to be really careful that NPF 4 isn't yet another layer of unintended consequences waiting to happen to damage this sector that we really need to support. And the Scottish Government has committed to supporting.
Thank you for that. Julia, do you have anything you want to add on?
It will not surprise you to know that I'm not an expert on NPF 4, but I do think that this question of it being hard to evidence the economic benefit of change of use outweighing the economic benefit of residential use, to me, there is a sort of analogue with something that the City of Edinburgh Council has said to us, which is that it's not proposed to carry out economic assessment of the licensing arrangements because Scottish Government already undertook a business and regulatory impact assessment. You know, these things are not the same. And if there is a keen interest in a proper 360-degree impact assessment, then that should be being applied before major decisions are being made about what changes the legislation will wrought, rather than in retrospect and by trying to aggregate every single individual case, because it doesn't usually work like that.
Yeah. Thank you for that. And we've touched upon already planning permissions around existing homes and short-term lets out with of control areas. But I just wondered, from your opinion, and given where we are with these the new regulations, where you think there's a way of resolving this to almost tweak the system which has been put in place to make this work? I don't want to just focus on Edinburgh, but as an Edinburgh MSP, I will. There's obviously a very major event issue which the legislation has come up against, which is our festival. Is there ways of then developing specific exemptions that you've submitted to the committee to provide for that, but also for the health and safety part of this, which is what the Scottish Government originally said this was about?
Well, I feel there's a precedent there already on the health and safety, which is that you don't have to have licensing if you are hosting a student, whether that student mm-hmm. be of, you know, adult age or of school age, if they're, you know, attending a language school. So it is not the case that the legislation thinks that all properties should be regulated in all, licensed in all circumstances. And if it's legitimate to host a young language learner for a brief period of time, then I feel that there's no real case for it to be illegitimate to host an adult festival worker, especially when, you know, in other bits of the housing system, you can have a lodger in your house without declaring yourself as a landlord, without having to be licensed as a landlord. So I don't think it's that difficult to draw the parallels across the use cases, let's say, that the committee and the government have before them. On the other issue of secondary short-term lets, I think it is a question of getting the best evidence base for what the impacts are, both positive and negative, of making these changes. I don't pretend that that's easy, and that's not something that the festival directors collectively are taking a view on, because we don't think we're the people who can make that decision. But certainly the evidence base for that seems to be something that you know, we put something in the public domain, which we copied to you as evidence, was a bar chart using published information on things like tourism figures and numbers of Airbnbs. We know that the figures in there can be interpreted and analysed in different ways. And we know that the ASSC has a different analysis of what the whole properties available through Airbnb and similar platforms are. But our point in starting that process is that we believe that the City of Edinburgh Council and the Scottish Government and other national agencies should be helping to improve those estimates and helping to understand what the scale of the problem is. Because if these segments of home letting, home sharing and secondary lets in whole properties that are not currently registered under planning permission are of anything like the magnitude that bar chart shows, then this is a very significant issue. And, I think before bringing in a blanket policy, that picture needs to be understood more carefully.
Yeah, and your specific call for that amendment around for Edinburgh during August as well, from what you've put forward. Fiona, do you have anything you want to add? If not, hand back to yourself, Kamina.
Yeah, thank you. I think whilst we believe temporary exemptions are a good option, suggesting that there would be an exemption from the requirements of the health and safety mandatory conditions for a short period of time would undermine the entire proposed purpose of this legislation. So I can't quite see how it would be okay to let somebody stay in an unsafe property for 6 weeks over the summer, whilst the rest of the year it's imperative that they need to meet all the mandatory conditions. I think that's one slightly difficult point. And I absolutely concur with Julia. The lack of data that has underpinned this legislation from day one has been deplorable. The first Indigo House report that was published in March 2018 that has been the bedrock on which all of this has been based was fundamentally flawed, and we complained to the Scottish Government about it at the time. The numbers that came out of that report, the 32,000 short-term lets in Scotland and 12,000 in Edinburgh, never existed, was completely incorrect. But that has become that narrative has become fact. And that is what we're basing all of this on. Now, if you look at the actual reality, and apologies to the rest of Scotland, but I'm going to go back to Edinburgh, there are 1,364 self-catering units on non-domestic rates in Edinburgh. There are currently about 4,500 entire properties in Edinburgh. Even the planning committee in Edinburgh said in February 2022, they've got a figure of 4,077 Airbnbs in Edinburgh. I hasten to add, an Airbnb is not a short-term let, is a Hoover, a vacuum cleaner, etc. But the fact is, we don't have the data. We need data before we make realistic, robust policy. And that has been fundamentally flawed all the way through this process, which is regrettable. But we have time to change that without continuing with all of these unintended consequences, which I think we've adequately evidenced in our written evidence.
Thank you. Thanks, Kamina.
Thanks, Miles. I'm now going to bring in Miles Griffin, who's joining us online.
Sure he can.
just wanted to direct a question to Fiona. Now, you spoke earlier about the need for the government to carry out a review. But if the government don't agree to that early review, you've also called for, I think, an urgent rewrite of the guidance that is in place. I just wonder if you like the opportunity to put on the record what you feel would be the reasons behind a rewrite, and what would you like to see in any potential revised guidance?
Thanks, Mark. We really welcome that. I think the first thing that I just want to reiterate once again is that the SSE is not against regulations. We've been calling for regulations since 2019. We suggested a registration scheme with mandatory health and safety. It's regrettable that it has been delivered via licensing, which is an authorisation scheme. We still think that a notification scheme would adequately suffice. If you look at private residential landlords, which is delivered by the Antisocial Behaviour Scotland Act 2004, that covers exactly the same health and safety provision and compliance that we are talking about for short-term lets. We absolutely do think that this is so damaging and so badly flawed that we should look at an alternative legislative conduit and not just go ahead with something that really fundamentally can't be fixed by a few tweaks. The investment barrier will continue whilst it is a licensing scheme. We need to go back and look at what the best conduit for this legislation is. So if you went back to antisocial behaviour legislation, that would cover your health and safety issues and your antisocial behaviour issues. And then you've also got your planning, which is already in place as part of the Planning Act 2019. So you're covering every single one of the policy objectives and the human interests that the Scottish Government is trying to deal with at this time without all the damaging unintended consequences. It's really also incredibly important that we look at giving grandfather rights to existing businesses. This uncertainty is devastating for businesses. It is impossible to continue working under these conditions. It really is. Whether it's under licensing or planning, we need to grandfather legitimate businesses that have not caused any problems for their communities for all of this time. And we've also got to stop blaming holiday accommodation for housing inadequacies. It is absolutely critical that we look at this very, very complex picture with greater vision and greater understanding without these knee-jerk reactions. I just think this is an amazing opportunity to get this right. The Tourism Strategy 2030, Outlook 2030, we need to grow tourism responsibly and sustainably, but this is not how to do it. And I just think this is an amazing opportunity to be world-leading and not regressive.
Okay, thanks for that. Hand back to you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Mark. I'm now going to bring in Annie Wells.
Hi, good morning, panel. Thank you, Convener. It was obviously we've heard a lot from both panels today, and it was just to see if there's anything else you think the committee should know about with the operation of short-term lets that we haven't already discussed today. So if there's anything you think we haven't touched on, if you would want to tell us any more about it. Julia?
Thank you. Thank you for the question. That's a great opportunity to say what's in my head. I'm trying to work out what that is. The operation of short-term lets has been happening de facto, I suppose, for the whole history of Edinburgh's festivals, and it would not be able to happen, the festivals, without some degree of surge capacity. So the most efficient way for that to happen is for, to find those routes for people to be able, without undue red tape, to make their homes available. There's then the underlying capacity for visitor accommodation across the city, and I think it's important as we move through this legislation that we maintain a distinction in our minds between those two things. The festivals do use underlying capacity, and so some of the issues that Fiona wishes to talk to you about on behalf of her association are relevant, but the thing that festivals directors are very keen for me to emphasise is that it's streamlining and making straightforward and clarifying that surge capacity that is a really big issue. It isn't about antisocial behaviour when you're talking about festival workers, because festival workers are in the city as cultural workers and not for party flats, you know. So there is a distinction there. And it is a mechanism which is considerably... I know that Cliff Haig was talking about 6 days in a Holiday Inn versus a flat. But one of the unique things about Edinburgh in August is that people come with their work, they bring their work to a marketplace, and they come for 2 or 3 weeks. And so that's a rather different visiting model from visiting short term. And the reason that 10% of Edinburgh's capacity is not taken up in the hotel rooms in August is because they're charging north of £500 per night for a room. And anybody who's tried to get a room over Hogmanay will realise that happens at that part of the season as well. So it's a very complicated dynamic. And I know that obviously I'm focusing on the capital. We have 500 suppliers across Scotland, and we have 1,000 performers across Scotland who come to the capital to meet the world. So I would say that although I don't want to overly weight the consideration to one local authority area, I think it is something that has repercussions across the whole nation.
Thanks very much for that, Julia. And Fiona.
Thank you very much indeed. I think really the critical point is that we need to revisit what the policy intentions are here. Is it housing? Is it health and safety? Or is it antisocial behaviour? I think we need to focus on the mandatory health and safety conditions, which is about the safety of the activity, and remind ourselves as to why we're doing this. And we can do that by using existing legislation and existing regulations. We shouldn't be duplicating regimes, which is what we're currently doing. We need to use existing planning legislation, which is up to date and meaningful, and we need to protect existing operators via grandfather rights. It is not fair to take people's businesses and livelihoods away from them. We need to remove the presumption of bad practice. I think it's absolutely critical that everybody remembers there are thousands of incredibly professional, incredible business operators out there that offer wonderful experience throughout the country. But all we're told is that we're puppy farmers, sex traffickers, and drug dealers. It's incredibly offensive. Let's remove that presumption of bad practice and celebrate the people that are good operators. And we need to remove the overreach, the issues of people getting out of hot tubs at 10 p.m. At what point do you tell anybody in the world they need to get out of a hot tub in 10 p.m. in any other accommodation sector? It's barbaric, it's extraordinary, and it's unenforceable. Therefore, it's incompetent. We need to withdraw all of those ultra-virus policies. And we just need to go back to the beginning and ask ourselves, what is the mischief that we are trying to solve here? Because at the moment, this is conflated to a point where it's impossible to unpick. So to that end, we believe that rather than tweaking the guidance or indeed the legislation as it stands, it requires a material rewrite. But going back to the intention of the meeting, and the convener at the beginning of this session said, yes, the delay is absolutely imperative in order to address all of the points that we've raised today.
Thank you, Fiona, and I'll hand back to the convener.
Thank you, Annie. I just want to clarify that I didn't say at the beginning of the meeting that any delay was imperative. I just noted that I read from Shona Robinson's letter about the... so it wasn't me saying that directly. So thank you very much for joining us today for the evidence. Colleagues, we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next two items in private. So as that was the last public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.